We used to be, in the second half of the 20th century, about equal in economic terms to Denmark and Sweden. But the crash of 28 changed all this. We are now far behind. And not only because of the crash, rather the crash exposed sort of fundamental weaknesses in the way that Iceland has run its economic affairs. And it will take quite an effort to make up for Iceland to be able to stand on an equal footing with the rest of the Nordic family. Something that is essential from the point of view of most Icelanders. So Iceland is basically a market-based economy like the rest of the OECD countries, but our market economy has been flawed out of deference to special interest groups that are more powerful in Iceland than in many other OECD countries. And a telling example of this is when the state banks were at long last privatized just before 2000. This happened, some time after all the private banks, public banks of the communist countries in Eastern Europe had been privatized. That shows you how late in the game Iceland was. And when time came to privatize, at last in Iceland, it was done by giving the banks basically for free almost to the cronies of the politicians, rather than selling them at proper prices to serious bank owners from abroad, the way it was done in Eastern Europe. Well, Iceland's traditional way of life is about the same as it used to be, but I think it has to be said that the crash of 28 opened the eyes of many Icelanders to things that were not right in Iceland. You know, Iceland is a deeply troubled country. Iceland is a deeply corrupt country. It is not that the people are corrupt, but rather the system that we have and the constitution that we still have has not been able to protect us against, has enabled politicians to exercise power in ways that were conducive to the crash. And this is deeply problematic. For example, when Gallup asked around the world 2 years ago whether people perceived corruption to be a serious problem in their countries, you know, 2/3 of the Icelandic respondents said yes, corruption is a big problem in Iceland. For comparison, it was only 14 or 15% of the people in Denmark and Sweden who think that those countries have corruption problems. So Iceland is, from this point of view, much more similar to places like Russia and Ukraine than it is to Denmark and Sweden. And then the question arises, has this always been so, or did the crash make Iceland corrupt? And people can discuss this. I think this has always been so, and what the crash did was to expose the flaws that have always been there, became more serious, but you know, it is not that Iceland was perfect until the crash, and then there were deep troubles. Our living standards were very high, exceeding even those in the Nordic countries in the years leading up to the crash. And there are two main reasons for this. One was that the exchange rate of the Icelandic currency was kept far too high. It was basically falsified by the central bank, creating an illusion of access, easy access to inexpensive imported goods and services. And then also the Icelandic economy was flooded by very inexpensive borrowed funds from abroad. And this was not sustainable either. So what happened in the crash was that suddenly the exchange rate of the Icelandic krona collapsed. It fell by a half. And suddenly the inflow of foreign loans stopped all of a sudden. And then the truth came to light. Iceland's living standards were significantly below those of Denmark and Sweden, and that is something that Icelanders cannot really allow to remain. We really need to show ourselves and show the rest of the world that we belonged in the Nordic family before, and we must regain our position as a valid and equal member of the Nordic family. Because, you know, if we fail at that, then the game is up. Why should young Icelanders then stay in Iceland? Why shouldn't they go to Denmark and Sweden? And this is essential for a country with only 300,000 people. Well, many people have blamed sort of neoliberalism for what went on. But I think that those emphases are a bit exaggerated, because the so-called right wing of Icelandic politics is not really all that right wing. They have much more in common, you know, with Russian politicians than with, say, right-wing politicians in Denmark or Sweden and Germany. So these are people who rely very much on the state for everything, even if they want the state to look the other way while they are robbing the banks from the inside and so on. So neoliberalism I never saw as a problem here. Rather, I saw inadequate implementation of market-friendly principles as a much more important problem. And one example of that is that when the banks were privatized, it was done by keeping the banks, you know, within calling distance of the politicians, by giving them to friendly cronies, rather than by selling the banks to foreign bank owners whom you didn't know and couldn't call, you know, if you needed to get loans at somebody else's expense. There is one significant difference between what happened in Ireland and in Iceland. In Ireland, it came to light that there were sort of corrupt relationships between the construction industry and the banks. And the privileged access of the construction companies to Irish banks was a significant part of the reason for the Irish crash. In Iceland, this has not been an important part of the equation as far as I can tell. Yes, there was a lot of construction activity going on. You could see this by just counting the construction cranes in the Reykjavik area. But it is not clear from the evidence that we have that there was something abnormal about the relationship between the construction firms on the one hand and the banks on the other. The sources of the Icelandic crash were of a different kind. They had to do with corrupt relationships between the politicians, the banks and big business. Remarkably, the price at which Icelandic energy has been sold to foreign companies over the years has been kept secret from the people. And this is remarkable because it is the people who own the energy. They are not being told at what price their possessions are being sold to foreigners. And this is a scandal. And this would not, you know, be something that people could get away with easily in other countries. And it needs to be changed. We need transparency. The people who own the energy, they deserve to be told at what price it is being sold to foreigners. But then there are environmental issues here, which have come to become much more important over the years. There is one different, important difference between the way that the Norwegians go about their big energy projects and the Icelanders, as my friend Omar Ragnarsson has pointed out so effectively. In Norway, you never do anything unless you make sure that the environmental effects are reversible. So you must, if you change your mind, be able to return nature to its original state. In Iceland, that principle has been violated. And I think that our descendants, when they realize the environmental consequences of this big energy project in the East, the most recent big one, I think they will think very harshly
of the people who made this happen. And the people who made this happen will then be gone, most of them. But this is disgraceful. And nobody has made a bigger contribution to opening Icelandic eyes to this than Ómar Ragnarsson. What happened in the years leading up to the crash was that the distribution of income became more rapidly unequal than has ever happened anywhere in the world, as far as I know. And this happened without any public debate, and this happened under circumstances where, when this was pointed out, the authorities actually denied that this was happening. So they lied about this. And Statistics Iceland looked the other way. After the crash, the conditions for making a quick buck with a little effort were certainly not as easily available as before the crash, so the difference between rich and poor narrowed again. What happened before the crash was that Iceland, that was used to be being sort of like Denmark and Sweden and Norway in terms of the distribution of income, had suddenly become much more like the US without any public debate. Now we are back on the way from the US toward the Nordic countries, but we are not quite there yet. It will take longer. The crash was a very dramatic event in Iceland. Three banks collapsed within the span of 1 week. And while this was happening, both people and firms were very uncertain about what would happen next. Would the banks open in the morning? Would they be able to go about their business, use their credit cards and so on, or not? And it turned out, actually, that the banks were able to stay open, that the credit cards were still usable, and this was actually quite well done by the Icelandic authorities with foreign help. But even so, the crash was a very dramatic and serious event. It was the biggest crash in the history of the world. If you measure the damage that was inflicted on people and firms, in proportion to the size of the economy where the crash happened. So the damage that was inflicted on people and firms at home and abroad is estimated by the International Monetary Fund to have been equivalent to 7 times Iceland's annual economic output. 5 times Iceland's output was inflicted on foreigners, including the creditors of the Icelandic banks and shareholders and so on, and the equivalent of 2 times Iceland's economic output per year was inflicted on Icelandic residents through a big dent in the stock market that was essentially wiped out overnight, and through heavy losses of the pension funds, to give you another example. So this was damage that had a huge effect on thousands and thousands of Icelanders. Many lost a significant part of their life savings. Some lost all of their life savings. Some had to be evicted from their homes, and so on. But you know, life goes on. But you know, for many people, they have to had to start from square one again. And this is not only a description of people who are 30 or 40 and have many years to make up. This also, and this is perhaps even more tragic, this also happened to some people who were 70 or 75 or 80 and have much less time to make up for the losses that were inflicted on them. So the Icelandic crash was a big tragedy. When the Icelandic banks proved unable to continue to borrow huge amounts from foreign banks, the Icelandic banks tried to make up by opening high interest internet accounts, the so-called CESifo accounts. And they promised very high interest rates, the highest on the market. And remarkably, there were depositors, especially in the UK and the Netherlands, who believed this and went for it and put a lot of money into these accounts. they should have become suspicious when they saw the high interest that was being offered, because history shows that banks that promise to pay very high interest rates sometimes do have no intention of returning the money. And this is exactly what happened in Iceland. I save accounts, so after they had sort of built up huge amounts in the Landsbanki, were suddenly made unavailable to the depositors when they wanted to withdraw their money. And this led to court cases and to negotiations between Iceland on the one hand and the UK and the Netherlands on the other. And the matter was ultimately settled in the EFTA court, which was, according to the financial architecture in Europe, the final arbiter in the case. Iceland got off the hook pretty easily for unexpected reasons, but even so, you know, many issues remain unresolved, and court cases will continue for quite some time before all the dust settles following the Icelandic crash.
Hello!